Open the pocket by holding the case near the LCD with one hand and pulling down on the sensor cover tab with the other. The sensor cover rotates and snaps into the open position. Place the prepared sample cup onto a level surface. Place the opened pocket onto the cup. If the instrument is not on, press the 1 button to turn on the instrument. Press the 1 button again to start the reading. Note that anytime you press the 1 button, it will restart the measurement. The sunburst animation shows that the measurement is in progress. When the reading is finished, the pocket will beep 5 times and the sunburst animation will disappear. Lift the pocket straight up to avoid spilling the sample material or contaminating the sensor. Before we actually take some sample measurements, we'd like to talk about sample preparation. When we tested how sample prep affects water activity readings, we found 5 things that will improve the accuracy of your readings. 1. Use clean sampling practices. Place your instrument in a clean location. Make sure you have clean hands or wear lab gloves. Use a clean sample cup for each reading. Fill your sample cup no more than half full. Wipe the bottom, the edges, and the rim of your sample cup with a Kim wipe before putting it in the instrument so you don't contaminate the sample chamber. Even small amounts of water or contamination can significantly affect the reading. 2. Protect your sample. The water activity of your sample changes as it's exposed to ambient conditions, so keep it covered. Put a lid on the sample if it will sit out for longer than a minute. If it will be waiting longer than a half an hour, seal the lid with parafilm. 3. Your sample temperature and block temperature need to be in the same general range before your reading can be taken. If it's too hot, water can condense on the inside of the sensor chamber. This ruins your water activity readings. If your sample is too hot or too cold, the instrument will ask you to take the sample out. If the temperature is only off by a few degrees, the instrument will wait as the sample comes to temperature. One way to reduce read times is by bringing the sample to temperature before putting it in the instrument. If the temperature differences are slowing down your read process, consider purchasing a temperature equilibration tray, which brings samples to a set temperature before you read them. 4. Take a representative sample. Whatever you put in the cup should be as close as possible to what the consumer takes out of the package. If the product won't fit, break it to fit, while minimizing handling. If it's a multi-component product like filled cake, cheese and crackers, or cereal with fruit, get a representative sample. By representative, we mean that all the components of the product should be represented in the same ratio as they are in the actual product. There are a couple of products that need special handling. Products with a moisture barrier, like coated candies, may be slow to come to equilibrium. They can be cut or crushed to expose the interior. Don't grind them, though. This causes moisture loss. In high-fat products, like fatty meat and desserts, the oil and fats become a moisture barrier. These products are slow to emit moisture. The sensors will work equally fast on these products, but the products themselves simply need a longer time to come to equilibration. A quick testing method will give you an inaccurate result. If you're testing these kinds of products, you may want to talk to someone on our support team about how to get the fastest, most accurate test results. 5. Minimize handling. In sample preparation, less is more. We've seen customers use all kinds of sample prep methods over the years. including grinders, food processors, and blenders. There are two problems here. First, the friction of the grinding process heats the sample, driving off moisture and changing its water activity. Second, the increased surface area means that the product loses or gains moisture more quickly, making it more susceptible to the effects of room humidity. Establish a standard operating procedure to specify how samples are prepared and be consistent. Your procedure should include how the sample is handled while waiting to be read and the temperature the sample and instrument should be at during the reading. When you set up this protocol, consider running your own tests to find which preparation method produces the most stable result. If the sample chamber or sensors become contaminated, your PAWKIT will not measure water activity correctly. The best way to check for contamination inside your instrument is by running verification standards each day you use your PAWKIT. The PAWKIT uses a two-point calibration. To perform an instrument verification, wash your hands or put on lab gloves. These verification standards are salt solutions with a known water activity value. They are tested with a densiometer to validate their accuracy. Standards are good for 1 year. Cover the bottom of a sample cup with a 0.76 standard solution. Place the PAWKIT on top of the sample and start the reading. If it's not in spec, clean your instrument. The standard should read between 0.74 and 0.78 AW, because the PAWKIT has an accuracy of plus or minus 0.02 AW. If it's in spec, you can move on to the 0.25 or 0.92 standard and complete the verification. Contaminants inside the sample chamber cause inaccurate readings and long read times. Contamination may or may not be visible. The best way to check for contamination is by verifying your instrument with the standards at the start of each day. If your verification standards read out of spec, the issue is almost always chamber contamination. Follow these cleaning steps and retest the instrument to resolve the problem. A cleaning kit is included with your PAWKIT. If you run out of cleaning supplies, you can order a replacement kit at sales.food@metergroup.com or by calling 509-332-5601. There are three steps to cleaning the sample chamber surface area and sensors. 1. Wash with isopropyl alcohol or cleaning solution. 2. Rinse with distilled water. 3. Dry with a clean chem wipe. To start, wash your hands thoroughly or wear lab gloves so dirt and natural oils on your hands don't contaminate the cleaning materials or the sensors. Note the location of the white filter that covers the capacitance sensor. This filter cannot be cleaned and should not be touched during the cleaning procedure. Later, we will show how to change the filter if it becomes contaminated. To clean the rest of the sample chamber, moisten a large chem wipe with isopropyl alcohol or cleaning solution and wipe down the surface areas of the sample chamber. Be very careful not to touch the white capacitance filter. Because of regulations, we do not ship isopropyl alcohol in the cleaning kits, but it's often the best cleaning agent, particularly if you're measuring samples with a high fat content. You can use any concentration of isopropyl alcohol greater than 90%. Change chem wipes frequently, even if they appear clean. If the chem wipe appears dirty after cleaning, get a new chem wipe and repeat the cleaning process. Now rinse the surface area just washed. Get a new large chem wipe and moisten it with clean distilled water and rinse thoroughly. Be careful not to dip a used chem wipe into the cleaning solution, alcohol, or distilled water to avoid cross-contamination. Dry the area with a new, dry chem wipe. To clean the thermopile sensor and the nooks and crannies of the sensor chamber, you'll use a chem wipe and a cleaning stick. Cover the end of the cleaning stick completely with the chem wipe strip. To do this, tear the strip in half. If you use a whole strip, it'll be too thick to fit into all the corners of the sample chamber. Hold the stick at a 45-degree angle. Fold the corner over the stick and twist several turns. Once the end of the stick is covered, fold the strip back toward you and twist the end around the stick. It's important not to use a commercial swab, because the adhesives used to glue the cotton to the stick will contaminate the mirror and sensors. Chem wipes won't scratch the sensors and are adhesive-free and low-lint. First, wash the thermopile by wiping across the sensor. Then wash and rinse the nooks and crannies of the sensor chamber using the chem wipe and the cleaning stick. Clean first with a clean chem wipe and isopropyl alcohol or cleaning solution. Then rinse with a fresh chem wipe and distilled water. And finally dry with a clean, dry chem wipe. Once the cleaning process is complete, let the PAWKIT dry for about 5 minutes while you prepare your water activity standards for verification. If your verification standard still reads out of spec after cleaning, you may need to adjust the calibration of your PAWKIT. Press the 2 button to enter calibration mode. The calibration menu allows you to adjust calibration up or down to match the 0.76, 0.25, or 0.92 standard. If the 0.76 standard is reading lower than it should be, navigate to U76. Adjust up for the 0.76 standard. If the reading is higher than it should be, navigate to the D76. Adjust down for the 0.76 standard. The scroll feature is continuous, so if the right screen is passed, keep pressing the 2 button until you cycle back. Scroll to the right screen and press the 1 button to adjust to the correct value. Each time you press 1, the value in the corner will change by 0.01 AW. Adjust the reading until it is correct, then press the 2 button until the letters STO appear on the screen. Press the 1 button to store the new calibration value. Please note that the 0.76 standard adjustment changes the calibration intercept, while 0.25 or 0.92 adjusts the slope. Because changes in the intercept are more likely to occur than changes in the slope, the 0.76 verification check is the most important and should be done more frequently. Thank you.